say too that for you, those of you afterwards, Guns N' Roses and played at the True Door. Sorry, first time since 1993. Now I'm not a big Guns N' Roses fan, but and I'm not saying it has anything to do with Ray's trip here. But just to let you know, I think it's about 11:30. So you know, probably. I think Axel is you're gonna hang around after me. Anyway, let me read you a bit about Ray. He obtained his PhD in philosophy from the University of Warwick in 2001, from 2002 to 2008. He was a research fellow at Middlesex University Center for Research in Modern European Philosophy. Since 2008, he's been associate professor of philosophy at the American University of Beirut. He's the author of Nihil Unbound, Enlightenment and Extinction, Palgrave 2007, and the English translator work by Alain Badiou and Quentin, Meillassoux. He's currently working on two books. One is about the American philosopher, Wilfrid Sellars, and is entitled Reasons, Patterns, and Processes, Sellars Transcendental Naturalism. The other is about the reality of appearances, entitled That Which Is Not. It investigates the ontological import of the appearance, reality, and distinction via readings of Plato, Kant, Hegel, Husserl, Heidegger, Badiou, and Sellars. So, without further ado, it's a great honor to present Ray Brassier.
Can people hear me okay? Okay. So, right, so this talk is basically, it's really an excerpt from this book I'm currently working on, which is a book I'm writing called Wilfrid Sellars. And I'm trying to explain part of the purpose of the book is to explain why his work is of general relevance, particularly to debates in contemporary continental philosophy. Although he's usually considered to be in the analytic tradition in philosophy, I think that Sellars' work is replete with extremely valuable lessons for continental philosophy, especially given the resurgence of interest in metaphysics, which has been much talked about in recent continental philosophy. So I think that Sellars shows you how it's possible to do metaphysics proper, and he is a Kantian metaphysician, and one of the things I'm going to do is to show why that is not oxymoronic, so that the contrast between Kantian critical philosophy on the one hand and metaphysics, which is an unfortunate consequence in terms of which the contemporary renovation of metaphysics has been prevented, is based on a confusion, a misunderstanding of Kantianism, the key insights of Kantianism, and also a confusion about, or rather kind of a caricature of the metaphysical task, and what metaphysics should be. So, topic of the talk is really the relationship between conception and sensation. I want to begin by talking about psychological nominalism. Psychological nominalism can be exemplified, it's really formulated in this thesis. Yes. All awareness of sorts resembles facts. All awareness of abstract entities, indeed all awareness even in particulars, is a linguistic affair. This is the definition, the canonical definition of psychological nominalism given by Sellars in his 1956 lecture, Empiricism and the Philosophy of Mind. And for philosophers of a realist stance, psychological nominalism, understood as a claim that all awareness is a linguistic affair, is of a piece with philosophical behaviorism, which allegedly denies the reality of consciousness. If psychological nominalism is complicit with this denial, which strikes many philosophers as absurd. Some would say it deserves to be relegated to the dustbin of philosophical history along with its behaviorist sibling. Sellars coined the expression, psychological nominalism, and defended the doctrine throughout his long philosophical career. But he also distinguished between two aspects of the mind, thinking and sensing, and laid claim to realism about both. This distinction between thinking and sensing, which can be traced back to Kant, essentially prefigures David Chalmers' more recent distinction between the functional, psychological, and the phenomenal slash experiential aspects of the mind. The crucial difference, however, is that while Chalmers endows phenomenal experiential states with a cognitive authority, equal to if not greater than that of functional psychological states, Sellars reserves cognition for functionally characterized thinking alone. And I'll try to explain what that means in the course of the talk. So he reserves cognition for functionally characterized thinking alone and characterizes sensation as a non-cognitive state that plays a causal but not a justificatory role in empirical knowledge. But one of the things I'd like to argue for tonight is that Sellars cannot be accused of downplaying the significance of the phenomenal or experiential aspects of the mind. Indeed, his account of sensory consciousness leads him to make the controversial claim that sensation has a metaphysical purchase insofar as it indirectly reveals a fundamental aspect of physical reality. Its intrinsic qualitative aspects, which, as Sellars sees it, cannot be reduced to the extrinsic or dispositional properties of things. And this is, again, this is another distinction which I hope will become clear in the course of the lecture. Now, Sellars' Rorschian errors in the Atlantic tradition have made much of his psychological nominalism, but they tend to dismiss his suggestion that sensation has a metaphysical purchase as an aberrant relapse into dogmatic rationalism. So what I want to do is argue that Sellars' account of the metaphysics of sensation is not a dogmatic regression because it offers a way of resolving the deadlock between realists whose equation of consciousness with knowledge leads them to embrace dualism, except for people like Chalmers, who thinks that experiential consciousness has a directly cognitive valence, and because it cannot be mechanistically or materialistically explained, conscious properties, the properties of conscious states, are fundamentally different in kind from the properties of material states. That's one branch of the dilemma. The other is the attempt to reduce consciousness to conceptual awareness. This is the claim, the alternative mood that's made by philosophers like Rorty or Robert Brandon in a certain regard, who want to say that all there is to consciousness is conceptual awareness. They take that to be kind of an exhaustive characterization of the nature of consciousness. But in doing so, the threat is that they will sever the causal link between mind and nature. So it's because the mind is embedded in nature that we need to explain, first of all, how, in a way, thinking, conceptual consciousness is irreducible to sensation, but we also need to explain how conceptual consciousness is constrained by sensation. In other words, how the mind is anchored in nature, and this anchoring is causal. It can only be causal anchor. Okay. Now, I'm going to use PowerPoints. Because I'm an incompetent PowerPoint user, I tend to put up either too much or too little on the slides. So I'm going to try, and I fear, anyway, I'll try to most of the content, the essential content of my argument is on these slides. So hopefully, they will, even if there's too much information, it will be useful very much. So, first thing to explain is how Sellars wants to, well, Sellars is a transcendental philosopher in the Kantian tradition who wants to avoid the twin excesses of dogmatic rationalism and skeptical empiricism. According to dogmatic rationalism, the mind enjoys a priori cognitive access to a mind-independent reality, such that reason can deduce the fundamental features of that reality. Skeptical empiricism, on the other hand, claims that all knowledge is rooted in but limited by sensory experience, so that reason cannot deliver a priori knowledge of a mind-independent reality. And what Sellars' claim is that both dogmatic rationalism and skeptical empiricism are part of the framework of givenness. They're enthralled in what he calls a framework of givenness, which is the belief that mental states are self-intonating. In other words, that to be conscious is to know what it is you're conscious of. Dogmatism, dogmatic rationalism, takes a correlation between thinking and being as given, as in Descartes. He thinks that I can deduce my own existence from my own self-consciousness, while skepticism takes the intelligibility of sensory experience as given. For Hume, for instance, what's interesting is that for all his skepticism about the objective correlates of sensory experience, he never, and his attempted decomposition of experience into these units, these elementary units of sensation, he never doubts that sensations can be intelligible in and of themselves, that there are intelligible units of sensation. And this is the other version of what Sellars calls the myth of the given. Sellars then wants to postulate a transcendental difference. And a way to reject the framework of givenness is to postulate a transcendental difference between thinking and knowing what is thought, between the act of thinking and the object of thought, and also a difference between sensing and knowing what is sensed. And this can be encapsulated in this Sellarsian dictum: the awareness of something is not the awareness of something as something. To be aware of something is not to be aware of it as the something that it is. This is the myth of the categorical game. So all that the word transcendental means for Sellars is simply postulating this difference between sensing and sensing as, or between experience and experiencing as. And this is all that Sellars needs, in a way, to gain critical purchase on the relationship between thinking and sensing. So, cognitive awareness for Sellars then will be a linguistic affair because it involves being aware of something as something. Such awareness requires conceptualization, and concepts are linguistically instantiated rules. We would not be aware, controversially, the claim is, we would not even be aware of ourselves as thinking were it not for language. This is Sellars' myth of Jones. And this, again, this is simply an immediate consequence of the rejection of the framework of givenness. It follows that if we need concepts to be aware of anything, it's not just that we need concepts to be aware of the objects of thinking or the objects of sensing, it's that we need a concept of thinking to be aware of ourselves as thinking or as feeling. The claim is that there's a distinction between consciousness and self-consciousness. Self-consciousness involves conceptual mediation, and the claim is that we, the kind of conceptual self-consciousness enjoyed by human beings or characteristic of creatures such as ourselves, depends upon language, depends upon linguistic resources, because language is the medium of conceptualization, at least in some sense. So, If one rejects the premise that thoughts are essentially self-intimating or self-disclosing, or the assumption that to think is to know that one is thinking, it becomes possible to understand the concept of thinking as modeled on the concept of speaking. Thoughts, then, according to the Sellarsian account, are understood as inner episodes modeled upon overt public utterances. These inner episodes are theoretical entities, postulated as structurally analogous to linguistic utterances, yet devoid of the physical characteristics of these utterances. They are silent, invisible, intangible, etc. And in this regard, then, thoughts are akin to theoretical unobservables. Okay? And this is the famous analogy between the postulation, that, you know, learning to explain the behavior of a sentient organisms in terms of beliefs and desires, or thoughts and sensations, is akin to postulating the behavior of gases in terms of imperceptible molecules. And in this regard, thoughts then can be, you know, this is a quote from Sellars, thoughts are in language-using animals as molecular impacts are in gases, and not as ghosts are in machines. Empirical observables are identified with the theoretical observables, without the former being the overt manifestation of the latter's covert existence. If you say that water is H2O, you're not saying that water is the manifestation of H2O. It's an identification. You're saying that water is H2O. H2O is the microphysical structure of this macrophysical phenomenon. And that is not like saying that the mind is this substance that inhabits the body. Okay? So it's very important then not to conflate the dualism of observational vocabulary and theoretical vocabulary with the dualism of inner and outer. And it's this dualism, the dualism of observable and unobservable, or postulation, or postulated, is not the dualism of outer and inner. Okay? You don't say that H2O is in water. That claim makes no logical sense. The claim is that water is H2O, and that it's, you know, the distinction between the macrophysical and microphysical is not one of spatial containment. If you understand, and this is the key to understanding psychological normalism. So, linguistic utterance then is not the exteriorization of thought, and thought is not the interiorization of utterance. Utterance itself becomes a thinking out loud, just as thinking becomes a silent saying. But theoretical terms acquire an observational role through which they can be used in perceptual reports. So we learn to perceive each other and ourselves as thinking, or believing, or hoping, or fearing, etc., etc. Now, Sellars' claim is not that thinking depends upon language. This is a metaphysical misinterpretation of psychological norms. The Ryleans in Sellars' account, that the creatures who think but don't yet have the concept of thinking, who are conscious but not yet self-conscious, they're still thinking. But they just don't understand or conceive of themselves as thinking beings. What they need is a theory, but they need a kind of a vocabulary to be able to, in a way, perceive themselves as thinking. So they don't think of themselves as thinking until Jones, genius Jones, and Sellars' account provides them with a concept of what it is to think. Because it's not at all obvious what it is to think. The concept of thinking is the least self-evident concept there is. You don't just tell whether or not something is thinking. It's an abstract theoretical concept. This is Sellars' whole point. By embracing Jones' theory of thoughts as inner episodes of saying, the Ryleans acquire the concept of thinking as what underlies meaningful utterance. They become aware of themselves as thinking. Once this move has been made, you can give the intentionality of thought is understood to be modeled on the intentionality of language. The concept of meaning to say, of intending, meaning something when one speaks, attention in the psychological and semantic sense, is ushered in with a shift from conscious to self-conscious thought. And this is precisely what Jones's theory of thoughts as inner episodes is supposed to explain. But it entails that the intentionality of public language is the condition for the intentionality of thought. And this is a sort of very controversial reversal. People usually assume it's the other way around, that the intentionality of thought is a condition for the intentionality of language. And Sellars says, no, it's actually the inverse. We have to be able to learn to use words properly before we can understand what it means to say something. Here's a quote from Sellars. From language of thought and its communication. Instead of analyzing the intentionality or aboutness of verbal behavior in terms of its expressing or being used to express classically conceived thoughts or beliefs, by classically conceived thoughts or beliefs, he means, in a way, the Augustinian or even Cartesian conception of thoughts as being ontologically independent attributes of some kind of substance, which cause behavior or cause linguistic activity. Instead of analyzing intentionality or aboutness of verbal behavior in terms of its expressing or being used to express classically conceived thoughts or beliefs, we should recognize that this verbal behavior is already thinking in its own right. And its intentionality or aboutness is simply the appropriateness of classifying it in terms which relate to the linguistic behavior of the group to which one belongs. And this is the second clause needs to be explained. What does Sellars mean here? It means that the intentionality of public discourse is a matter of appropriately classifying linguistic behavior according to standards encapsulated by collectively accepted norms. These norms involve the rules of criticism, or ought to be's, to which speakers are encouraged to conform, as well as the rules of action, or ought to do's, which speakers are expected to realize. Since rules of criticism and rules of action are codependent, ought to be's imply ought to do's. So conforming to the former is indissociable from accepting the latter. Linguistic action and linguistic behavior are both norm-governed. They cannot be opposed to one another, since the capacity to conform is the precondition for the ability to act. Again, what Sellars is trying to do is to overcome the binary between action and behavior, where action involves a kind of an intention, some kind of interior intention, whereas behavior is merely like the kind of outward manifestation of that intention. He's saying, once you dissolve the inside-outside dichotomy, you can understand behavior as intrinsically intentional. Okay? And so that the ability to behave correctly is evidence of the ability to understand something, to intend properly, and vice versa. So if psychological normalism identifies thinking with verbal behavior, this is not in the same sense in which psychological behaviorism, public kind, people like E.F. Skinner, etc., identifies thinking with behavioral dispositions. Verbal behavior expresses thought only insofar as thinking is understood as a kind of doing, cognitively modeled on linguistic utterance. So thinking is a kind of doing because it involves inferring, which in turn involves representing. I'm not going to say much about representing, but it's very important to emphasize the link between these verbs, these adverbs. Thinking, doing, inferring. Concepts are inferential roles, and these roles are defined by networks of implication across webs of linguistic assertion. To say that intentionality is the appropriateness of classifying a linguistic expression relative to the behavior of a linguistic community is to say that intentionality is a functional characteristic. So, because thinking is a kind of doing, the intention, in a way which is realized in thinking, has a function. This is why you can give a functional characterization of intention. And Sellars' dot-quoting device is the exhibition of this linguistic function. It's simply just a kind of a formal device introduced by Sellars, whereby the dot quotes, whenever you dot quote a linguistic expression, you show its function. You show what it does in a language. This, of course, presupposes familiarity with the dot quoted expression's proper function. And this familiarity is the background of tacit understanding against which the exhibition of the meaning of particular expressions can stand out as an instance of explicit understanding. Exhibiting the meaning of a specific expression is only possible against the backdrop of a language and a form of life within which the use of words is necessarily embedded. In other words, there is no transcendent context in terms of which you could judge the propriety of function, of semantic function. You measure the propriety of function according to a social context, social, historical, and cultural context, which is ultimately the manifestation of what Wittgenstein calls a form of life. So at one level, you can't, this is why meaning can't be defined. You cannot define what meaning is, you can only show it. Because meaning is about function, and to understand a function, you can't give a kind of a propositional encapsulation of the function, you can only show it. And this exhibition or showing, rather than stating a complex rule-governed functioning, which presupposes familiarity with the language in which the dot-quoting device is deployed, re-embeds language within a world of practical involvement. Because when you show the meaning of a term, you can only, you know, that exhibition is only comprehensible to someone who understands, to someone who knows how the dot-quoted term is already being used. So, consequently, Sellars' psychological nominalism and his claim that cognitive functioning is linguistically instantiated envelops awareness within language only insofar as language itself is enveloped in a world comprising a variety of human practices and purposes. Drawing out those conditions exposes the chain of nested mediation from awareness to awareness as, from awareness as to conceptual role, from conceptual role to linguistic practice, and from linguistic practice to a world of practical involvement. And what is exposed through this chain of mediations is the way in which the content of any single state of awareness is bound up with a context of significance that includes a whole practical life form. So, psychological nominalism is usually reproached for denying the reality of mental states. But if anti-realism in this context means denying that mental states belong in the world, then this reproach is misguided. Or, on Sellars' account, mental states are as real as anything else in the world, of which they are a part. The fact that cognitive awareness of mental states is conceptual through and through in no way compromises their reality, since, on Sellars' account, this is as true of tables, zebras, and galaxies as it is of thoughts and sensations. Everything is conceptually mediated. All the ontological furniture of reality is apprehended conceptually. So thoughts and sensations would be no different in this regard. But if the issue is one of realism, the more fitting reproach to psychological nominalism and to the transcendental stance from which it ensues is that realism, whether about mental states or non-mental phenomena, comes at the price of an exorbitant holism, which is obliged to take as given a total context of significance, i.e. a form of life in which the transcendental perspective is necessarily embedded. Why should this be so? On Sellars' account, the ought to be's and ought to do's, which condition all our thinking and acting, constitutes the linguistic framework within which we live. This framework furnishes the resources for all justification and evaluation. Although claims made within the framework can be assessed, criticized, or rejected, there is no higher authority or court of appeal with regard to which the framework as a whole could be judged and found wanting. Then the danger is one of quietism. This is a famous quote from Wittgenstein's Uncertainty. You must bear in mind that the language game is not based on grounds. It is not reasonable or unreasonable. It is there, like our life. If our linguistic framework is simply there, like our life, it is not susceptible of rational revision. It is just something to be accepted as it is. And Sellars's emphasis on holism, both semantic and epistemic, would seem to point towards a quietest acceptance of the form of life within which we find ourselves as the ineluctable horizon of all thinking and doing. If the rejection of the empiricist and rationalist versions of givenness ultimately entails accepting the givenness of a form of life as the ultimate horizon circumscribing reflection, this may prove too high a price, because transcendental reflection will then find itself constitutively incapable of critically interrogating the legitimacy of the practices, and specifically of the cognitive practices, within which psychological states and conceptual roles are necessarily embedded. Now, Sellars rejects this whole, so this kind of quietism. So, and this is really tied to his whole account or his preoccupation with the status of sensation. Sellars' conception of philosophy is a theoretical endeavor requiring conceptual construction as well as conceptual revision is opposed to this quietism. The root of this opposition lies in Sellars' bifurcated holism. Our understanding of the world is split into two competing conceptual structures, the manifest and scientific images of man and the world. Both are autonomous categorical schemes, neither of which can be wholly subsumed within the other. But the bifurcation is in our conceptual grasp of the world, not in the world as such. So Sellars' transcendental dualism of images should not be taken to be incompatible with monism. In fact, it's a kind of double aspect theory of a Spinozist kind. He's not saying that there's the world, there's two different kind of dimensions of reality. There's only one world, but it appears, or it's kind of, it's apprehended from two distinct vantage points. And that's, you know, from the manifest image vantage point or from the scientific image. Now, both those images, though, are connected, as we'll see. Sellars accords to the scientific image the peculiar privilege of describing and explaining why the world appears to us as it does. And this is what the manifest image cannot do. Transcendental reflection within the bounds of the manifest image reveals normative practice as the fundamental horizon of understanding, but it cannot explain why the world manifests itself to us as it does, or why we engage in these particular practices, but not others. Indeed, such questions make no sense so long as transcendental investigation is confined to the manifest image. However, these questions are perfectly legitimate if one understands the task of transcendental reflection to be that of articulating the two images. So, for Sellars said, ultimately the common sense picture, or the manifest image of the world, in spite of its delicate coherence, poses problems which it lacks the resources to resolve. And the topic of sensation is crucial because it lies at the interface between the two images. It is the juncture between the causal nexus investigated by science and the normative space of reasons within which we conduct our daily lives. So this is why, for Sellars, sensations are essential to the explanation of how we come to construct the appearance which is the manifest world. So in response to the charge that holism entails quietism, it's worth pointing out that Sellars' bifurcated holism makes room for conceptual revision because it allows for the possibility of diagnosing categorical dysfunctions, not only within each image, but also across the two images. Categorical dysfunction, because concepts are functions. The functioning of any single concept is bound up with a whole economy of concepts. So, if a concept is malfunctioning, that malfunction will ramify across the whole structure. And in fact, there are in a way, the symptoms of categorical dysfunction are simply philosophical perplexity. That's why philosophy, in a way, tracks categorical dysfunction. So, Sellars' controversial proposal for a metaphysics of pure processes exemplifies his critical or constructive conception of philosophy because it's motivated by a concern over the malfunctioning of the category of sensation, and not by dogmatic deference towards the epistemic authority of thought, as his argument has been misunderstood as the latter. Since thoughts can be characterized in terms of their functional roles, Sellars insists that, quote, there is no barrier in principle to the identification of conceptual thinking with neurophysiological process. So the conceptual role of, let's say, red rectangular as a conceptual predicate is identified through dot quoting as the metalinguistic circle, dot quote, red rectangular, undot quote. And this linguistic function is at least in principle identifiable with a set of physical states in which its particular tokenings are realized. But although sensation can be functionally characterized as a sensing red triangle, Sellars adopts what he calls an adverbial theory of sensation, so that the sensation of a red triangle is actually a sensing red triangularly. And that way you remove the idea that there has to be some kind of object or sensation. Sensation is not object involved, but it has an intentionality. It's about something. What it's about is not some kind of thing, some peculiar item in the world, such as a sense data. The difficulty about sensing red triangular is that it cannot be identified with its functional role. So to understand why sensation cannot be identified with its functional role, we must distinguish between the formal and the content properties of objects. Formal properties include all of an object's causal, dispositional, and structural properties. They are conceptual. I.e., causal, you know, what the object's, you know, its causal powers, what it makes happen, dispositional, its propensities, a pane of glass has a disposition to shatter, and structural properties. Structural properties can be microphysical properties. All these properties are charted by mathematical science, they're conceptual. The content properties comprise the object's sensible properties in the strict sense. Whatever can only be directly seen, touched, heard, tasted, or smelled of an object. So, while the formal properties are categorical features of objects, the latter, the content properties, are purely occurrent qualities. And this is Sellars' account of an occurrence, of the contrast between occurrent and categorical properties. Quote, we do not perceive of the object its causal properties. What we see of it are its occurrent sensible features. This can now be generalized as follows. We do not perceive of the object its character as a substance having attributes, its character as belonging with other substances in a system of interacting substances, its character as conforming to laws of nature. In short, we do not perceive of the object what might be called categorical features. The reason is that if we could simply perceive the categorical features of objects, we wouldn't need science. Theoretical science would be completely superfluous. It's precisely because we can't see, directly perceive, what objects can do, how they behave under certain circumstances, that we need to do science. What we perceive are the occurrence, you know, the sensory properties of objects through what they look like, what they smell like, what they sound like, what they feel like, or what they taste like. So what we see of an object are its sensible content properties, while what we see an object as are its conceptual or categorical features. And the latter are intuitive, not sensed. Now, this is a lengthy quote from Sellars, but it's important because in a way it amplifies this distinction. And it's why Sellars thinks an account of the world merely in terms of causal, dispositional, or structural properties is going to be unsatisfactory. And this is where Sellars' account rejoins the concerns of metaphysicians such as Alfred North Whitehead. So, this is Sellars. It should be noted that if physical objects are genuine individuals, they can scarcely have only iffy properties, i.e., if and only if properties, causal or dispositional properties, the kinds of properties that are formulated in physical laws, for instance. Iffy properties, powers, propensities, dispositional properties, and the like, they must have some non-dispositional or recurrent attributes. But nor, as Whitehead reminds us, will it do to limit their recurrent attributes to such primary qualities as shape and size. For, to use an Aristotelian turn of phrase, geometrical qualities are formal qualities and presuppose a content or a matter, thus color. Things which had primary qualities without content qualities would have vacuous actuality. This is Whitehead's expression. That Whitehead construed the occurrent content of physical objects in terms of feeling rather than color is a symptom of the revisionary character of his metaphysics. Now, you need to try and understand what's going on in this quote. Whitehead construes occurrent content in terms of feeling because he is a pan-experientialist, for whom, or a panpsychist, for whom actuality divorced from subjectivity is necessarily vacuous. In other words, actuality, the actuality of any property or feature must be registered in a subject. There has to be a subject of sensation, of a current sensation. And a vacuous actuality in Whitehead's sense is a non-subjective actuality, an unperceived actuality wholly independent of subjective experience. So at the root of Whitehead's pan-experientialism lies a conflation of sensing with perceiving, or of awareness with awareness as. Sellars is too Kantian to accept Whitehead's revisionary recategorization of a current physical content as an instance of feeling. He endorses the traditional characterization of the metaphysical task as the identification of ultimate categories understood as summa genera. Categories in general, says Sellars, are classifications of conceptual goals. So now, what does this mean? It means that the metaphysical task is to properly classify, to identify what categories do, what role they play in our understanding and describing of reality. So like Kant, Sellars views categories as ways of classifying conceptual representings rather than as the attributes of unrepresented things. He removes, Aristotle thought that categories were in things. And Kant replaces categories in us, not in things. The categories, the pure concepts of the understanding, according to Kant, are in us. And they're the condition of possibility for our experiencing things as being thus and so. Thus, Sellars insists that metaphysics must accurately describe our extant categorical framework, i.e. our extant ways of representing things, before engaging in the revisionary task of postulating new categories or recategorizing entities. So from the viewpoint of descriptive metaphysics, which Sellars endorses, the category of actuality is not subordinate to the category of subjectivity as species to genus. They are distinct genera. Something can be actual without being experienced. Why would you claim that something's actuality depends upon its being experienced. That's the premise of pan-experiential, which is a peculiar premise, which is unnecessary for Sellars things. A current actuality manifests itself to us through sensation, and sensations are current states of perceiving subjects, but they need to be conceptually apperceived, i.e. represented to be known by the subject whose states they are. So, now we come to the so-called brain argument. So, although current contents are revealed through sensation, sensation reveals to us the occurrence, contents, the content properties of things. Sensation itself is not the cognitive awareness of occurring contents. And this is what prevents Sellars from embracing Whitehead's pan-experientialism, as well as the kind of property dualism championed by Chalmers and others. It's also why Sellars' so-called brain argument for the irreducibility of content qualities is not phenomenological, or at least not as that term is used by analytical philosophers. Sellars' brain argument proceeds from what he calls the principle of reducibility, which Sellars formulates as follows. If an object is, in a strict sense, a system of objects, then every property of the object must consist in the fact that its constituents have such and such qualities and stand in such and such relations, or roughly, every property of a system of objects consists of properties of and relations between its constituents. So the properties of a whole can be reduced to its parts if and only if all the properties of the whole can be explained in terms of properties and relations of its constituents. This seems relatively uncontroversial. But it presents a problem for giving a reductive account of sensation. Because sensations, according to Sellars, are characterized by ultimate homogeneity. This is another quote. This is Sellars' famous pink ice cube. The reason it's a pink ice cube is because he's a devotee of martinis and spent a lot of his life looking through martini glasses. So that's why the pink ice cube is the example. The ice cube presents itself to us as ultimately homogeneous. And an ice cube variegated in color is, though not homogeneous in its specific color, ultimately homogeneous in the sense to which I am calling attention with respect to the generic trait of being colored. That's my emphasis. The generic trait of being colored. Homogeneity, then, pertains to the generic, which is to say the categorical trait of being colored, and not to a current pinkness as such. The pink is seen as homogeneous insofar as it is a color, but homogeneity is not something one sees of the ice cube. Or more precisely, it is the coloredness of the ice cube that is seen as homogeneous rather than its current pinkness. This is to say that homogeneity is not an occurrent content property, but a formal generic property of pink as a species of color. Now, it's because of this account of homogeneity that Sellars thinks that we need to forge a new category to be able to understand what sensations are. Because sensations can be functionally characterized without remainder, we need to come up with a category that will allow us to account for the homogeneity of sensation, the homogeneity of content property. And this is where the concept of pure processes comes in. This is a quote from Sellars' Foundations for Metaphysics of Pure Processes. What is primary in the various senses of the verb to buzz is the concept of the intrinsic character of a certain kind of process which can be identified in terms of its typical causes. The verb to buzz then would have a sense in which processes of that intrinsic kind would be buzzings, even when they were not being brought about by one of these typical causes. Thus, in this sense of the verb to buzz, we could say that a buzzing is going on without implying that some object, e.g. a bee, is buzzing. So, buzzing then, as an occurrent content quality, is irreducible to the formal properties of its constituents, i.e. the activity of the bee. And this then means that the concept of an absolute process, or a pure process, an absolute process is contrasted to an object-bound process. Once you start understanding buzzing as something that occurs independently of bees, okay, the bees in a way that kind of whose activity in a way kind of generates the buzzing, you understand that there's something about the buzzing which is an occurrent quality, which is not object-bound, in Sellars' term. It's, there's something going on that it can't, is, that is not the effect of an underlying cause. So the concept of an absolute process is the concept of an intrinsic quality occurring independently of the properties of objects or relations amongst objects. The buzzing is irreducible to the properties of the bees, or the relations between the bees, just as the pinkness of the ice cube is irreducible to the properties of the molecules, you know, the ice molecules, or relations between those molecules. This occurrent aspect is decisive not only because it allows us to conceptualize content qualities independently of any object that might bear them, but also because it provides us with a paradigm of an absolute occurring. An occurring that is not attributable to something that begins and ceases to occur. So this is why, for Sellars, in the case of absolute processes, we can speak of absolute coming to be and ceasing to be. Because when a sounding, for instance, a C-sharping begins, there is nothing which begins, in the relevant sense, to sound. So in Sellars, by the same token, it's not, although we talk about bees buzzing, the buzzing itself, strictly speaking, can be understood to be going on independently of anything that the bees are doing. There are three then basic characteristics of absolute process. Intrinsicality. An absolute process is characterized by an intrinsic quality, a somehowness. The somehowness is like a current, is the pinkness of the pink ice, the very pinkness of the pink ice cube in the case of color. It's the very, you know, the buzzing, the very buzzingness of the buzzing in the case of, example of the bees. That's the intrinsicality, it's an intrinsic quality. A currentness, the fact that this is it's a kind of a pure actuality. And finally, homogeneity. What Sellars then does is postulate what he calls sensa as theoretical entities which occur as the components of absolute processes traversing the nervous systems of sentient organisms without all absolute processes involving senses. So the claim is this, is that sensation can play the causal role that they play in causing certain states of awareness because they involve occurrent content qualities which have an autonomous and independent ontological status. These current content qualities can't be attributed or explained in terms of the microphysical components of sentient organisms. Okay, in other words, no matter how hard you look, you will never find anything corresponding to the quality of the sensation in the nervous system of the organism that is experiencing that sensation. The sensa then, the sensum, singular or the sensa plural, is the theoretical state, the thing that is being registered by the organism. Now, sensa are components of absolute processes, but not all absolute processes are sensing, involve sensing. So the characteristics of processes are defined without any reference to organisms, and these are the characteristics of absolute process: intrinsicality, occurrence, homogeneity. There's nothing here that involves a reference to sentience as such. This is why Sellars is not quite there. So, sensa then processes are physical. But now we need to distinguish between two different senses of physical, a generic and a specific sense of physical, to understand how it's possible to claim that sensory processes are physical. The generic sense of physical, an entity is said to be physical, one, if it exists in the framework of space and time. The specific sense in which something can be said to be physical is if it's definable in terms of theoretical primitives, adequate to describe completely the actual states, though not necessarily the potentialities of the universe before the appearance of life. What needs to be understood is the relationship then between sensings and processes. Okay? And here's another kind of quite lengthy quote, which I'll try to unpack. This is Sellars again. Whereas the objects of contemporary neurophysiological theory are taken to consist of neurons, which consist of molecules, which consist of quarks, all of which are physical two objects, specifically physical objects, an ideal successor theory formulated in terms of absolute processes, both findings and rowings. What findings and rowings are basically variables, theoretical variables, associated with pure processes in the generic sense and pure processes in the specific sense. Okay? The fine-tuning is something that Sellars calls a quarking or an electron. Okay? This is a process which is physical too, okay? Which applies to independently of organic life. Whereas a rowing is a sensory process. It's an occurrence sensor. So these might so constitute certain of its objects, i.e. neurons in the visual cortex, that they had rowings as ingredients, differing in this respect from purely physical structures. Okay. So what does this mean? Okay. It means rowings are things like readings, buzzings, and C sharpings. Okay. These are sensory cortex. These would be construed as constituents of nervous systems alongside neurons and the particular entities of which neurons are composed, i.e. molecules and quarks. They would be understood as objects abstracted from underlying physical two processes, such as quarkings and electronings. In the final analysis, however, both quarkings and readings, i.e. both findings and rowings, these two, the generic and specific kind of process, would be physical. The ultimate claim would be a kind of physics, a fully developed physics, that is capable of integrating the sensory states of organisms. You no longer have this, in a way, this discontinuity between the inorganic and the organic, which plagues a lot of contemporary philosophers. And in a way, there's lots of philosophers who try to kind of dissolve this continuity, but to Sellars' point, you cannot just do it by fiat. You can't just wish it away. You have to work, you have to generate the conceptual resources to actually to bridge the gap, to achieve properly an explanatory theoretical solution to the discontinuity between the inorganic and the organic. If homogeneity is a structural categorical feature of a representation. It need not be attributable to the organism's component parts to be explicable in terms of their properties and relations. And this means that while the reducibility of a current pinkness for a content property requires its attribution to the constituent parts of the object bearing the property, the reducibility of the homogeneity of a current pink does not. Homogeneity of form does not equal the homogeneity of content. This is why, ultimately, homogeneity is not a current. Homogeneity is a property of a current property, such as sensations, but it is not itself an occurrent property, an intrinsic feature of sensation. To qualify a property as a current is also to qualify it as homogeneous, since the property of homogeneity is entailed by the property of occurrence. But to qualify a property as homogeneous is not to say that it's occurrence. Now, the point here is that I think that there's a problem with Sellars's analysis, his categorical analysis here. In other words, I think that although if we return to the three basic characteristics of processes, intrinsicality, occurrence, and homogeneity, Sellars has made a plausible case for the intrinsicality and occurrenceness as fundamental characteristics of processes, but not of homogeneity. So I think this is the limitation of his analysis. And this is important because the argument works on the basis of diagnosing a categorical dysfunction. So again, Sellars has been misinterpreted, I think, as someone who is whose motivation for this metaphysics of pure processes is an unwillingness, is simply a kind of table pounding about the undeniable reality of sensory consciousness. But that's not the structure of his argument at all. I think his argument, he wants to be able to account for the phenomenon of sensation for explanatory reasons, because sensation is what ties us to the world. And it's also because he thinks that the world must have content as well as form. You cannot just think, you can't have this dualism of form and content, where mathematical science tracks the form of reality without being able to account for its content. The content remains as something I do not want. So he wants to be able to integrate form and content, and to be able to, he wants science to have traction upon the content of reality. And I think his account is immensely attractive and plausible, but I think it falters at the level of his analysis of homogeneity. I think I'll stop.
Okay. But I think that it is a different thing to say that thoughts proper have construction?
If they have ontological content, they would just follow that nature has at least some items with constitutional form. And obviously, it doesn't want to. I think that the reason that he thinks that this is not problematic is because he says that with regards to thoughts, they are reducible to, you know, the universal logical constituents of the organs. So maybe it's because of that that he doesn't think that possible thoughts and instances is problematic. And I'm not sure about this reduction either. He says that, you know, the reduction of thoughts to universal logical states is problematic. Sensations is where the trouble is in the expanding science. I'm not entirely sure, but the very least it seems clear that thoughts are thoughts, but thoughts are thoughts, and thoughts are thoughts. And that would be a total of physics, unless we come by what's
yes. You're right, that there's an ambiguity in the accounts. On one hand, he seems to be saying, because, in a way, thoughts, thinking as conceptualization, conceptual thoughts, which is functionally accounted for. So it's thoughts, conceptual states are realized in. Behavior of organisms, but also the behavior of, you know, the social dimension, but also a complicated network of articulation of thoughts. In other words, because no organism can think on its own, so whatever state you're in when you're thinking has got to be coordinated with, you know, the states of other specifics. So, in one sense, this makes so Sellars defends a kind of classic substrate independence. So the same function can be realized at different physical substrates. And why? Because he thinks in a way there's not. They're not ontological items because, in a way, to characterize someone as thinking or as believing in something as a soul is not to give them a very good description, it's to give a norm as a description. So, in a way, thoughts don't belong to the ontological order, so they're norm as a right. Norms are not things in nature. However, at the same time, they're not just, you can't simply. They're not nothing either, and they have to be articulated. So in other words, thoughts have to be articulated in nature. And here, Sellars resists the kind of, you know, François was onto something like second nature. Don't we just say, well, we don't need to worry. There's first nature, which science tells us about, and there's second nature. And second nature can be explained as perfectly natural. So we are rational animals, and our rationality is this capacity that we have. Because of our second nature. But then when Dow would be applied just about explaining, you can't explain what second nature is. I think it's in the position. But Sellars, in a way, wants to be, doesn't want to think that possible. He wants to articulate reasons in the world. Even if he's very clear that reasons are not things in the world, which they're not things at all.
I think that's why he thinks it's not problematic. Thoughts can be in one way reduced to mere physiological sense of words.
Yes.
Whereas with sense, you really need something much like that. Now, I'm not sure, I don't remember the argumentative thread by which in which he's claiming that thoughts can be reduced to problematically, but I remember thinking, this is a thing which.
Yes, I mean, operate in one sense. I mean, not, you can't have a type like that. I guess it's a biological or a physical
which you can make calculations and so on. It doesn't seem very good. I mean, homogeneity is a blockage for sensing. And he thinks there is no such property or quality that stands as a barrier for the reduction of the case of thoughts. But I'm sure it's.
Yes, no, I think you're right. There is something very. I think there is a tension. The tension is that on the one hand, Sellars wants, he doesn't want to, you know, I think he equivocates. He equivocates between the claim that scientific image, I'm not even going to describe it as and if ontology is understood as just involving description and explanation, then science is the measurable, what is, you know, that it is and what is not that it's not. However, manifest image, you know, a lot of thinking isn't, lots of the things that state organisms do isn't just describing and explaining. So lots of our doings can't simply be recaptured at the level of the scientific control. But he wants us to say that they're just as real. So in a way, I think he's a bit of a double standard. He wants to be able to say that they, you know, believings, hopings, you know, any kind of conceptual thinking state is perfectly real in terms of the manifest image. But he says that's the proper domain in which to journey to reality. You can't, it's a mistake, you know, to go across the images, to try to look for something in the scientific image that corresponds to. It's like the adding to the two tables. It's just you're confusing. It's a badly posed question because you're confusing two different distinct categories. But the consequence is that Sellars, I think the one aside for it, is that implicit in Sellars is a claim that science itself isn't bound to the ontology of objects or of cause and effect. It's driving it dynamic feedback between the manifest and scientific image, because what is isn't just substance. And you can't understand the reality of the world in terms of the thing paradigm and the impact of things banging on against each other. And what I take him to be doing with this is this metaphysical lecture is this is why he thinks there is a constructive task for philosophy. Is to say something about our understanding of what it means for something to be. This is he's proposing a transformation in our understanding of what it means to be, so that we don't identify being with substances, actual substances, object and substance.
Okay. So you spoke about categorical distinction and the role of philosophy in diagnosing categorical distinction. And my question is, if art is thoughtful, if art can be a form of philosophy, and I'm speaking about non-linguistic art, can that also diagnose categorical distinction? And if so, how would non-linguistic arts differ from the world?
I think, what I'm going to say is going to be very tentative. It's a very difficult question. I would be inclined to say yes, because in a way, if art is sophisticated thinking, although it's non-linguistic for the most part, it can identify, when an artist says it's not possible to do this in this way, the sense that there's a way of doing things, a way of playing, a way of painting, a way of performing, that is, that seems to be a kind of exhausted or it's kind of its potency has kind of lapsed. say that that's a kind of identification of a, not a dysfunction. It's a dysfunction, you need a word other than dysfunction, because dysfunction in the context in which it's important here means really kind of understanding, describing, explaining, understanding. But also, concepts that they're pointing out aren't simply about describing and explaining. They have, they're much more complex, and they have all, you know, they have values and dimensions. Also, they're not so dependent upon the economy as a whole as these kind of cognitive concepts are, concepts like sensation. So in a way they have, you have these kind of, you have a kind of a continent of concepts, but then there will be a peninsula, clusters of concepts, which have like a degree of relative autonomy vis-a-vis the mainland. If you think of like artistic discourse, this kind of peninsula, you know, conceptual offshoot, then they're not, you know, the normative constraints there are, need not be those of you know, the main, of what's going on in the economy. And that means that there's, we need special kind of cognitive expertise, and we familiarity with a very kind of specific concept to be able to identify what's right or wrong about something, about some mode of artistic doing. So my answer to the question would be yes, but we need a word other than destruction, because how, what art is supposed to do, or what, like, you know, what you're supposed to be doing when play or perform or make something, you know, is always a much more complicated order of magnitude, more complicated than, you know, the norms that govern our everyday doing. There's a right and a wrong way, you know, to get dressed, to get, you know, to talk, to speak, to eat, to drink, and these are relevant. But when you get to culture in particular, it just gets vastly more complicated. So dysfunction would be the point. Dysfunction is, it implies that everyone already agrees about what the relevant standard is, which is not the case. Yes, but the reason it doesn't play, it plays a functional role if it's considered conceptual. But the content, what's going on when you're sensing red triangle, isn't just conceptual. Because concepts, in a way, are just forms. And what's going on in sensation, there's content. There's, when you're seeing red triangle, there's something, you know, there's an experiential component, which is not, need not be there when you use the word triangle.
So my second question is, can that concept be less images?
Conceptless images or visual sensations?
That's a distinction. I was thinking images, because
something else something. Okay. If an image is seeing something, both seeing and it's going to be conceptual. Seeing all of it is not necessarily conceptual. In other words, so you can see the redness of something without seeing it as red. And certain neurological disorders, those two things become disconnected. So if you're using the word image as something that has a coherent structure, which involves seeing something as something, it's going to be conceptual. I don't know how something would be, I mean, I think you can have, if you mean like a retinal image.
I mean that.
Okay, my tendency would be to say that it's going to be conceptual.
So then
it's all
children that are engaged in the natural brain world.
Thanks for a very interesting talk. Remember I saw this before? I was hoping you could please just briefly clarify what sense it is. My understanding of it from the talk is that it's distinct from, like, for example, the concept of red or the sensation of red, but I'm not really sure how it fits.
Actually, okay, yes. So I should have explained that. Really, I'm using the word sensing. He then uses the word sensor to take over from sensor. What he simply means is your sensory state. Your sensory state that accompanies any kind of consciousness. What he's saying, because we don't know what sensory states are, we can mark our ignorance by using, there's something there that needs to be filled in. A sensor is the placeholder, it's a theoretical posture, it's a placeholder for the concept of sensory experience that we do not yet have, but which needs to be constructed. So a sensor is just, it's another word for sensation, but what we mean by sensation now is kind of confused. We can understand what someone means when they say they are having a sensation, but it's a profoundly equivocal concept. In order for us to know what sensation is, we're going to have to do work, we're going to have to refine and revise the concept, and that's what sensor is. Sensor is just a technical term for what sensation will ultimately turn out to be. Once we're clear about what.
So almost sensation prior to conceptualization or understanding. Okay. And a second question. A lot of your talk today seem to resonate with the practices of meditation. Mm-hmm. I was wondering if that was an influence for you.
It's not an influence on me. I'm not fortunate, but I don't know. I doubt the Sellars. Drag. I mean, that explains a lot of this as well.
I wanted to ask a somewhat zoomed out macro question because I think certainly in the talk you said that Sellars, as someone who thinks that the kind of philosophy that we have in the context of philosophy, such a big broad question kind of gave me that. I mean, for me, Sellars is an analytic philosopher in a couple of ways. Just traditionally with cognitive philosophers, we do get, especially with individuals, strong interest in ontology. But then a lot of consequences that fall out of that ontology about political ramifications and those are very understandable as well as self-reviews. And so, I guess my question is, I'm kind of trying to think through this tradition as seeing traditional talking to friends of the how does Sellars not include some fundamental ontology as it relates to you, and how might that process of talking to someone who's like, say,
valence to his work. However, I do think his work does have two implications. One is that one is basically defending in a way the primacy of conceptualization and of conceptual rationality over attempts to subordinate it to some more fundamental non-cognitive relationship to the world. So in other words, he goes against the grain of much continental philosophy that valorizes the non-cognitive over the cognitive, and then that construes cognition, representation, conceptualization as a pernicious instrumental rationality. Okay? Cognition is just about manipulating things, and manipulation is reprehensible because of cognitive. This basically Nietzschean concepts or instruments for deploying things so that conceptualization will be in bias. I think that is a terrible view, which is politically catastrophic. Completely politicized. And so the first thing I would say is that once you see that you don't need the dichotomy between, see, it's either concepts or either reason is purely contemplative and therefore it is kind of reactionary because it's just about withdrawing from the world, to seclude yourself in this realm of pure ideation. All reason is purely instrumental, it's just an instrument for getting what you want. But then it's governed by these pathologies. Pathologies of instrumental rationality. That's a false dichotomy. You've been given accounts of rationality which is neither platonic, contemplative, nor kind of Nietzschean and instrumental. This is what he gives you. So he talks about thinking as a kind of doing. And it's the most fundamental thing of doing that we do. We do it all the time. And so if we can understand how we're doing it and what's going on, that will affect a really profound consequences upon our ability to kind of to realize our purpose, our goals. And that's straightforwardly put it, seems to me. The claim is that there's nothing about our experience, or there's nothing about the world that is inherently refractory to understanding. There's nothing about the world that is inexplicable, unfathomable, etc., etc. Therefore, that means that if you understand something, change it. And I see that as a very necessary corrective to the whole pathos of incapacity, inability, failure, debility, which are really very prevalent rhetorical trope in a lot of contemporary fundamental philosophy. Even in the logic metaphysics, you get this kind of intensification. It's either about intensification or disintensification. But then you get kind of the sensitization of thought, which I also think is all about. With Sellars, you can re-articulate, you've got a kind of conceptual rationality, which understands it as being bound up with history and culture. But not simply this kind of unwitting pawn of non-rational agencies. It defends the autonomy of the conception while anchoring it. And that, I think, is very profound, and it's politically very profound. I think it can be circled in time to Marx. Long-term project. I want to articulate in Sellars' differentials account with the kind of accounts and social systems that can get installed into it. It's the missing link. It's clear to me that this is where is the obvious necessary component of philosophy. Something like a story. He thinks that concepts are material entities. Concept is a real material entity. In fact, he claimed there is that it's material inference that determines content and concept, so that formal inference is just in a second order meta-level extrapolation from relations amongst assertions, concept informed assertions. Now, concept, for Sellars, there's two things. On one level, see, he has a kind of a, he gives an account of what he calls animal representation system. So he thinks that animals can represent the world in a conceptual form. He thinks he can characterize something as being this such. So he thinks what he calls animal representation systems, they can pinpoint, they can refer to something and characterize it in terms of a certain feature which allows them to kind of track it and re-identify it. But this is, this kind of conceptual form is not yet propositional. It's not propositional form because you're not predicating something of the subject, so to speak. So he thinks that conceptual form and propositional form are distinct. Need to be able to put the world into some kind of conceptual form before you can generate propositional form, before you can predicate properties of particular instances.
So does that mean concepts receive opposition to it?
Yes.
Is that the opposition to it? Or receive different forms?
There, you would say, well, I mean, again, the Kant is not, they're not concepts, they're proto-concepts, which means that anything that has a referring and characterizing function, is that's the basic kind of, you need to be able to refer and to refer to and characterize salient features of the environment before you can do anything else. Okay? And our ability, obviously, to speak and then to say things about the world, we're already kind of presupposed this more rudimentary referring and characterizing, which is representation. Concepts are not representational. Concepts are not representational because they are simply defined in terms of what he calls material inferences, where a material inference is the example is it's raining, the streets will be wet. The connection between rain and wet streets is not a logical connection. It's a connection that is that the world inculcates in us. So I use the kind of organisms are kind of human association. They form associations between things in the world. So once you can learn to connect to things like rain and wet streets, and the point is that the content, what it, you know, the concept rain is materially involved with the concept of wetness. So that as soon as you think rain, you think wetness. But the connection between the two involves kind of like an automatic transition. Inference doesn't begin logic. So material inference is not logic. Simply kind of something you call an association. But that association provides the content that generates concepts. And then logic then develops a very long complicated process when you develop resources to explain relations of connection or disconnection or exclusion between thoughts or assertions, contentful thoughts or assertions. So material inference takes precedence over formal inference. In fact, formal inference presupposes, logic presupposes meaning. There wouldn't be any logic if there wasn't meaning. Meaning involves association, involves being exposed to features of all that. Actually, this is why sensation is also fundamental. If you didn't have a nervous system, if you weren't hooked up to the world in the right way, you wouldn't be able to acquire concepts. They wouldn't have any content. And in order for them to have content, there has to be something looking at. The organism must be capable of registering kind of regular actions and patterns in the world. But then this is not yet conceptual content because conceptual content needs to be ruled out. And rules then are in a way it's a self-consciousness here, but to know, to understand what the concept rain is to understand why anything that is rained upon will be wet, to understand the conditions under which something is rained upon won't be wet, for instance, if someone protecting it, etc. And then that complicated understanding the systematic connections between those two things is what it means to master the concept. But you would never have the concept in the first place.
if you didn't have a nervous system.
The sort of content is he says, empirical experience, although the world doesn't cause us to have concepts, but there's some way in which it provides the basic platform upon which our conceptual capacities can be formed. In other words, you need to be on a nervous system and to be doing two things in the world. They need community, they need intersubjectivity. I think that's the missing one. That's what makes a difference. Once you have a community of speakers, then you have a full-blown conceptualization. And these are the issues. Sellars are great peers, and he's obviously in for a fight. And I'm trying to determine the scope of the interest. But I think much, I mean, I think he agrees with what I'd like to see. Really significant over the techniques. This is not a classic kind of Turing machine function. This is a kind of function, but it's a normative function as opposed to causal function. And classic computation famously identifies functions. Functions are identified in terms of their causal roles. Functions causally defined. And here, because of the influence of normativity, function is normative. This is why the analogy is all with the games. And the problem then is that it's very difficult to come up with an algorithmic decomposition for normative function. So, you know, the proprieties that govern any of the concepts we use, but also our social practices, are actually very difficult to break down into a series of discrete algorithmic steps, which you could then program. And so in this regard, this account is more along
which is not to say that they're uncomputable. This is not to say that they're uncomputable.
saying is that thinking and sensing really need to be distinguished. They can't simply be juxtaposed or broken apart. Now, Loki thinks of thinking that are useful to sensing. He doesn't think that thinking can be abstracted from sensing. That you can build thinking machines that build sense. He thinks there's something about thinking that is bound up with our However, this means that you need to think about how to kind of articulate those things. And it means that the prospect of machine intelligence or artificial intelligence is just more complicated. Just vastly more complicated than perhaps it being imagined. Also because it involves a kind of community, that you can't be intelligent on your own. You need a kind of social context. So that means that you need a kind of complicated social organization in order to be able to sort of exercise these in common. So that means that simply that the kinds of machine intelligence, even like chess playing computers for all their purposes, are just like toy models. This is not a defeatist perspective. It's not a sense. This is developing machine intelligence is obviously something that should be done. But there's a Cartesian / Kantian conception of evolution, which includes a lot of our research on evolution, which is inadequate to attacks. Robert Brandon is very influenced by such a very interesting paper called Why Philosophy and Scale Problems of Science, which is about this very issue. He's someone who's sitting here who's saying artificial intelligence, the scientific understanding of what is involved in technological rationality is obviously desirable, but the scientists have been hampered by philosophical preconceptions. They've inherited preconceptions from the tradition that are inhibiting the task.
Yeah, I also want to know
let me see if I can try and mention that. are tied to any practical activity or practical doing. They're not simply tools, they're not simply instruments, utilitarian tools, things which are tied to non-conceptual interests. In other words, the claim here is that although thinking is a kind of doing, the kind of doing is specific and irreducible. You can't, the doing, what you're doing when you're thinking, can be reduced to what you're doing when you're not thinking. Very simple. That's what it means. And the people who say that it is are just wrong. And because they don't really understand what thinking is. So, for instance, the claim that what you're doing when you're thinking can be explained in terms of something else, or some kind of some biological or physical compulsion is mistaken, because thinking has, although it is, it can be shaped by those kind of extra cognitive interests, it has its own intrinsic nature and autonomy. And that is shown by the fact that you can have second thoughts, that you can reflect, you can ask yourself whether or not you're right to think what it is you're thinking, whether what you think is right or wrong. And that capacity is needs to be explained. You can't just say it doesn't exist. So in this regard, this is why thinking is not simply framing the world in terms of a set of pre-existing irrational interests or agenda. That's an instrumental rationality. It says all you're doing when you're thinking is you just want to get something done, and central thinking is just a kind of an analog of this non-rational. So this whole account denies this. Obviously, it has common repulsion in particular, and with always a surprise that anyone would deny this, because it seems to be obvious to them. However, it doesn't deny that thinking relies upon irrational kind of happenings and going on in the world. Thinking is something that evolved as a kind of biological history, but then also as a kind of very complicated cultural and social history. The ability to think is a combination of both very peculiar biological factors, the fact that we're apes. Apes seem to have certain kind of very interesting cognitive prowesses, unlike those of other kind of creatures. There's all sorts of empirical kind of research about this. At the level of 2 years, all of a sudden the ability to kind of to learn certain techniques can become this kind of ratcheting effect, where certain kind of creates, they learn how to do something, they can immediately think because of mimicry, because of imitation, that kind of that skill is not only disseminated in the population, but then starts to evolve. It starts on your transformation. It's obviously that kind of non-linguistic cognitive prowess played a role in us developing language and the other kind of cognitive capacities. But what happens is that once thinking is on the scene, once kind of rationality is on the scene, you can't explain it away. You can't just say it's really this, it's something else instead. It evolves from things that are not rational, or kind of simply be understood as things happen in the world, but it's irreducible.
Metaphysicism, Architecture, and Politics with Matthew Poole and Manuel Schwartzberg. So if you're all interested in architecture and in applying in politics in terms of parametricism, please come. Okay? So join me in.